everyone, and welcome to City Light. We're looking forward to a time of worshiping together. I'm going to read from Psalm 121. It says this: I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Let's all stand as Joe leads us and come, people of the risen King.
Jesus, for your great love that you demonstrated toward us. And Lord, we just thank you for bringing us here today. We pray you tune our hearts to sing praise to you. Lord, open our ears and our hearts to receive your word. We pray for Pastor Kenny that you'd give him a great wisdom to rightly divide the word of truth. And Lord, we pray for our dear brother Roger and his family this day. Lord, we pray you'd encourage them. Lord, though we all mourn for the loss of our sister Rosemary, we take great comfort, Lord, in the hope that we have that there is a day of the restoration of all things that is coming. Lord, as we have borne the image of Adam, the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of Christ. So we rejoice in this truth, Lord. We just pray you be honored and glorified this day in Jesus' precious name.
You may be seated. We'll continue singing this morning with Be Unto Your Name.
We are
Forever Jesus. If you'll stand with us as we sing, our hymn of the month for June is Forever Jesus. I want to mention, if you're a guest with us this morning, we'd love for you to fill out the Connect card. It's a way for us to get to know you and how we can be maybe a blessing in your life. I mention this pretty much every week, but there is a space in the back to list any prayer requests, and we'd love for you to fill that out. We take time during the week to be praying through those requests, so I just want to mention, if you're a guest, please fill that out. You can hand it to me at the end of the service in the back of the lobby. If you've forgotten, today is Father's Day, so if you haven't bought a gift, well, you're behind the eight ball, but you better late than never is what I say. So make sure you take care of all the dads. We have a gift for every dad on the back tables, and so
Dads, when you're leaving, we have a gift bag for you. We hope that you'll grab that. And everyone else, you know, you can't claim that as the gift that you had planned for your dad, but it's just a bonus from the church. All the guys are leaving for, and the ladies actually, are leaving for camp on Monday. There is a form that needs to be filled out. They're doing medical screening when we arrive. And I wrote down here the form. You need to check no to every answer. Otherwise, there's no point going. Okay. So if you don't mind, if you're going to camp right here on the piano side, we'll have those forms. And we'd like you just to go ahead and fill the form out right now so we have those all checked off. Before we head out, you'll notice that we're leaving at 6 a.m. tomorrow. I encourage you to arrive around 5:45 so they can load the trailer, and they're going to be heading out at 6 a.m. very diligently. They have their stops picked. Heather and I were planning on going, but we have a memorial service on Thursday, so we won't be going. But Pastor Theron and Bethany, Joe and Amanda will be heading out with all the teens and juniors to camp. Looking forward for them having an exciting week. I'll be praying for that. It's going to be a little different. Again, some of the restrictions are there, but we're excited. We'll be the first week of camp at the Wilds. Again, last year we were the first week a little earlier, but they're excited about that. We're looking forward to them being at camp and that time of focused energy. A lot of fun, but also preaching through God's word and that they'll grow spiritually. So be praying for that. I want to mention this. Our small groups will start July. We're going to start July 8th. Originally, we were thinking July 1st, but July 8th made more sense. And so if you haven't grabbed a book, we were able to get a few more books. Pray Big. It's a book written by Alistair Begg. Looking forward to praying like an apostle. So look at that. There's opportunity to meet Madison, Orange, Culpeper. And again, I mentioned this, if you're going to be Zooming in, we'll have a Zoom option as well for Bible study. Luis in Brazil is planning on Zooming in and joining our Bible study that way. And so we're excited about that. He joined us this past Wednesday from Brazil. And so we're looking forward to maintaining that connection, praying that things work out for him there, get his college finished. He's actually planning on coming back and interning at the church for a year, and there's a chance that he'll be going back to Brazil after that year and planting a church, and we'd be intricately involved in that. So just want to mention that for everyone. We're still not passing the offering plates, but I want to mention you can drop your offering off in the plates at the back that the guys have on the table there, or continue giving online. Again, I'm extremely grateful for our church's generosity. We have not had to stop any ministry, and actually we're able to take on a missionary during COVID. And so we're really grateful for the generosity of the Lord's people and allowing the church to continue functioning. And as Theron comes up to read the scripture, I want to mention this, and you could pick up from Mr. Price's prayer. Rosemary McNamara passed away on Thursday, 2:30 a.m., and we're going to have a memorial service here on Thursday, this coming Thursday at 10 a.m. We'll be having a meal following that service. So if you're able to make a side dish, the church is going to provide the bread, the drinks, and the meat. If you can make a side dish, whether it's a cold or hot or a dessert, please sign up on the back table. If you're making a hot side, if you don't mind taking one of the pans that we have, that allows us to place that right on a sterno and keep it hot. And so we'd encourage you to sign up for that. We're looking forward to the meal afterwards. And if you're able to make it, I want to encourage you to come out at 10 a.m. We're going to celebrate Mrs. Mack's life. She has laid out the funeral service exactly how she wanted, but she said she wants us to be rejoicing. And so we're going to rejoice in a life well-lived. We'll have a chance that we'll be sharing the gospel. So those that come that maybe don't know Christ as their Savior are going to hear the truth. But we're going to take some time to sing and rejoice in a life well lived and celebrate what she dedicated her life to. So again, if you're able to help out and make a dish, please sign up on the back. And if it's a hot side dish, please grab a pan so that we can put those on the sterno.
All right, our scripture reading this morning is from Mark chapter number 5, kind of a big chunk this morning, 21 through 43. If you want to follow along in your Bibles, you can, or just follow on the screen. Mark chapter 5, starting in verse 21. And when Jesus was passed over again by ship unto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet and besought him greatly, saying, My little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she shall live. And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. And a certain woman, which had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was nothing bettered, but rather grew worse, when she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment. For she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, who touched my clothes? And his disciples said unto him, thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, who touched me? And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him, and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace, and be whole of thy plague. While he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, be not afraid, only believe. And he suffered no man to follow him, save Peter and James and John, the brother of James. And he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult, and them that wept and wailed greatly. And when he was come in, he saith unto them, why make ye this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn. But when he had put them all out, he taketh the father and the mother of the damsel, and them that were with him, and entered in where the damsel was lying. And he took the damsel by the hand, and said unto her, Talitha kumi, which is being interpreted, damsel, I say unto thee, arise. And straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of 12 years. And they were astonished with a great astonishment. And he charged them straightly that no man should know it, and commanded that something should be given her to eat.
Before Pastor comes with the message this morning, we'll sing all three verses of Holy Spirit.
Spirit.
The gospel story is told by Mark, scene after scene, building on each other. And this is a third in a series that starts with the storm, and then we have the demoniac, and now we're dealing with disease and death, crushing disease and death. There's an older folk song from the 70s called The Cats in the Cradle. It's a song about relationships, specifically the one between a boy and his father. The lyrics, though, tell a very sad story. Actually, the songwriter picked the lyrics up from a poem that his wife had written regarding that, and then he adapted it to a song. It's a dad that is too busy with his life and basically completely unavailable to take time with his son. His child is born, it says, in the usual way, but there were planes to catch and bills to pay. He learned to walk while I was away. Another verse says this: "When my son turned 10 just the other day, he said, 'Thanks for the ball, Dad. Come on, let's play. Could you teach me to throw?' I said, 'Not today. I got a lot to do.'" Unavailable again. The song ends with the son grown and the dad retired, with the roles reversed. The son has grown up just like dad and is perpetually too busy to be accessible, too busy to be available. And it's one of those songs, and I put song/poems, that leaves an eerie feeling when you hear it, because it exposes how quickly we are unavailable or inaccessible to those we love most. It exposes how our life and our interest are above all others. Here's what we do with that, though. We then catapult that emotion onto our Lord and Savior. We often think God responds to us this way, that God is too busy or unavailable for us. But that's the furthest thing from the truth, and we see the exact opposite here in this scene from Mark, a scene that shows Jesus crushing disease and death, and that's an overriding principle we want to grab, because we're going to look at the fact that he was over nature, the storm, he was over the supernatural in the work with the demoniac, and now we see him that he proves his power over the physical, which is disease and death. What do we fear the most? We fear dying. We fear getting a disease. So our health, and then the fact that death comes. And so we're going to see in this crushing of disease and death and manifesting his power over our greatest physical fears, he's going to also show us clearly that he is available and he's capable. The availability of Christ and the capability of Christ. Now, after healing the demon-possessed man on the eastern shore, remember what happened. We were teaching. We've now took a boat across the Sea of Galilee, a lake, basically, from western, northwestern shore to the eastern shore. The people there have requested that Christ leave, and so he boards the boat. So he does the miracle with the demoniac. You see the pigs crash into the ocean. The people come and they ask Christ to leave. He gets in a boat, he leaves, and so he's returning now to the northwest shore that he has just left. He's been gone less than a day. Recognize that. This is not spans of weeks. This is less than a day. You can imagine that the same people are ready to swamp him, that when he left, he was crowded in by people. He's in a boat teaching. He ends his teaching, and he immediately goes to the eastern shore. He's on the eastern shore. He heals the demoniac. They ask him to leave. He leaves and goes right back to where he came from. So in other words, it's been less than a day, and the same people are all milling around. Not that they didn't go home and come back, but there's not a big gap of time here. And so as he arrives on the shore, he gets swamped again. The crowd is so large that he remained by the seashore. He was nigh unto the sea. In other words, he couldn't even move through. He couldn't land there. And remember, he's gone through quite the 2 days. He was swamped at the house in Capernaum. He goes to the sea to teach. He doesn't stop and go to the shore. He goes all the way across the lake. The storms arise. He heals the demoniac. He comes back, and there's so many people milling around that he just sticks by the sea. And into this mob, an important citizen approaches, coming from town. Jairus, the ruler of the synagogue, has come to plead with Jesus to heal his daughter, who is at the brink of death. That's what the words mean there. Now, the ruler of the synagogue was a layperson, so he's not a rabbi, he's not a Pharisee or a Sadducee, but he's a critical person in the community. He was managing the synagogue, the services, who would teach, who would have the position, how it flows, all those things were controlled by him. And Jesus, though pressed by so many, goes with him. So when he initially arrives, he's at the sea. There's so many people with so many needs that he's just going to stay by the sea. And then this one person comes and says, "My daughter is dying. Come heal her." And now he makes his way through the crowd. Along the way, a woman who has suffered for 12 years in a last attempt at healing works her way through the crowd to just touch his robe, hoping and believing it will be enough to heal her. She reaches out, it says, and touches the fringe, is what we're talking about, of his robe. She doesn't grab his clothes, but touches the fringe. A lot of times Jewish men would have tassels on their robes. There's a good chance to just touch the tassel on the bottom, and she's healed. Jesus, knowing that she was healed, looks around for the one who touched him, something the disciples find incredulous. Why are you looking for people who touch you? You're in a crowd. People are constantly bumping into you. People are constantly touching you. But Jesus wants to talk with the woman. He knows that he healed her. He's not surprised. It's not like, oh, she stole my power. He is aware of all of this. He's still God. And so he wants to speak with her. She steps forward and shares her whole story. Jesus acknowledges her faith. And by the way, it's a faith that brought more than just physical healing. And tells her she is completely healed for good from this illness. She recognized that her problem had stopped. There's no assurance, though, for her, that it stopped for good. He does give her that assurance, and he affirms a redemptive faith before that. As Jesus is speaking to her, people come from Jairus' house and let him know it's too late. His daughter has died. Jesus immediately encourages Jairus to not be afraid, but instead to believe. And the word there is to continue to believe. Jairus has believed, and now his faith, that fledgling, simple faith, is being tested to the max. And he says, keep believing, keep believing. Now Jesus only allows Peter, James, and John to continue with him, and they go with Jairus to his house. There's a crowd following. All his disciples are with him. This is one of the first times you see him pull the three disciples apart, the inner circle, so to speak. He doesn't allow anyone else to follow him. Jairus and the three disciples and Jesus head to Jairus' house. As they enter the home, they're confronted by the chaos of an ensuing funeral. Now remember, we have a funeral. It is a much more somber affair. There's quietness. There's a sense of, I call, dignity and respect that's there. That's not how Jewish culture had a funeral. They went and ramped the emotions up to the highest level. You would hire people to sing by law, and this is not biblical law, but by law that they had for their society, even the poorest person had to hire two singers and at least one flute player. So you have flute players playing sad music, you have people wailing professionally, and this is what they walk into, because a funeral was a loud, chaotic affair that took place soon after death. I want you to recognize something. Jairus left to go find Jesus to heal his daughter. She's so close to death that all the professional singers have been prearranged to show up. They've booked the entourage. It's ready to go. So by the time he gets back, it has already started. The wailing is there. Jesus confronts the professional mourners and basically tells them to stop because she is only sleeping. What does the Bible say? They immediately mock and ridicule him. Why is that? They've seen dead people before, and they know she's dead. It's another way to affirm that she wasn't just in a coma. She was dead, and they knew it. Humanly speaking, that little girl had passed away. Jesus sends, and really, it's a nice way of saying he forced them out of the house. He takes the father and mother along with the three disciples and goes to where she's lying. He takes her hand, and it says in Aramaic, by the way, that's not Hebrew, it's Aramaic, Talitha Kumi. Mark is actually the only one to record the Aramaic words. And it actually means little one, or actually little lamb. They use damsel or little maiden, but it's a little lamb, arise. It's a command. She gets up and walks. And I want you to recognize this. Before she passed away, she's laying in bed sick. She's at the point of death. He doesn't just bring her back to life. He actually brings her back to life. And in the same breath, she is healed completely. Thus, the reference to her walking. All her physical capabilities are returned. Any semblance of the illness is completely gone. Everyone is amazed, yet Jesus requests them to keep this quiet and to give the girl something to eat. She hasn't been eating. Feed her. She's hungry now. Very practical ending. MacArthur notes this, Mark's account focuses on two individuals out of the massive multitude who desperately needed Jesus. There's a multitude of people that meet that boat at the shore. Mark zeroes in on these two people. They had very little in common, except for the dire nature of their circumstances. One was a man, the other a woman. One is wealthy, the other poor. One is respected, one is rejected. One is honored, the other is ashamed. One leads the synagogue, the other is excommunicated from the synagogue. One has a 12-year-old child, the other with a 12-year-old illness. Though they have no obvious relationship to one another, in God's perfect providence, their lives intersected that day in an unforgettable way. What happened? They both experienced firsthand the availability and capability of Christ as he crushes disease and death. So as we are building, as Mark is sharing through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Christ's ultimate power, we're seeing how available Christ is and how capable Christ is. You see, he has the power to heal, to bring to life, yet he remains accessible to all people. And as we embark on this scene, we're reminded immediately of the availability of Christ. Note that, the availability of Christ. One author notes this, the Son of God not only had the creative ability to heal and give life, he also had the desire to do so. He was available to all people. By application, he is available to us. I want you to go back to the scene in your mind. So I've told the story in a general format. I want you to return to the seaside. You get off of a boat. You've had quite the run for the last 36 hours. The crowd is pressing in, surrounded by masses of humanity, all seeking something from him. I want you to recognize this. These are not just neutral people. Every person is coming to the seashore seeking something from Christ, whether that is their own healing, whether it's healing for a family member, whether it's to hear more great teaching, whatever it is, they're coming in and they're pulling from Christ. I want you to see that there's a high amount of need present in this crowd. Into the mayhem comes a synagogue ruler, one of the upper class in Capernaum, and by the way, not your usual follower of Christ, who falls down before Jesus saying, my little daughter lieth at the point of death. And as I mentioned before, she is at death's door. Hospice has already been called in. If you want to put it in our context, it is a hopeless situation. He's left his home going for the last possible option that's there. And he says, I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her that she may be healed and she shall live. Not maybe she'll live, she shall live. And it's a pretty bold statement of faith in what Jesus could accomplish. I don't want you to minimize Jairus' faith. Here's a man with a lot to lose by bowing down before Jesus. There's a host of Pharisees and Sadducees and people from the high priest grouping that have been sent up to condemn Christ, that have undermined Christ. He leads the synagogue. He has a position. This is not popular. He literally walks into a crowd of people, the people that he, quote unquote, has rule or management over, and he grovels at Christ's feet, begging him to do something that he believed Christ could do. You can only imagine that he hears the crowds building up and recognizes that Christ has returned and he's coming down to get him. And though many pressed in upon him, upon Christ, many are clamoring for his attention, and the need for him at the seaside was great. I want you to recognize this. A mass of people who need him. We still find a Savior who is ready to hear. He's ready to hear. Jairus is given an audience. He's heard by the Savior. I put a question down. How many of us recognize that our Lord and Savior stands ready to hear? I want us to catch two main things from this story. One is that he has the power over disease and death. That is the overarching point that Mark's trying to make. As he's writing to a Roman audience that is afflicted by Nero, that is hiding in tombs, that is facing this immense persecution, he's showing them that they worship the only one. But I want you to see something here, that Christ is available, and he makes that very clear in the situation, a very individual availability. But do we recognize that our Lord and Savior stands ready to hear? Yet he's not just a sympathetic listener. See, you take all the religions that are out there and you do a cross-section, especially of the Eastern religions, and you find a lot of gods who are willing to just sit there and listen. They're a statue that listens to you very sympathetically. And there's a lot of words that are given to imply that you can meditate, you can think on them, you can talk to them. There is always a sympathetic listener in the realms of the religions of this world, but Christ is not just a sympathetic listener. He is also ready to respond. He's ready to hear and he's ready to respond. With Jairus, what does he do that's very practical? He immediately went with him. He's at the seaside. Thousands are there. Yet this guy walks in and has a need, and not only does Christ listen to him, he's a sympathetic listener, he is ready to respond. He immediately went with him, following him back to his house. Think about this. Everyone needed him there. You could justify Christ saying, I'd love to go back to your house, but I mean, look at all these people that need me. There's a host of people who need me here. It'd be unfair for me to go back to your house. No, instead, Christ responded to Jairus and went with him, and the people followed behind. I wrote this down: the massive call of the multitude did not negate the need of the individual. In Christ, each person has value, has an audience. We're not just heard in the masses, we're heard individually by him. Jesus went with him. Now, along the way, the whole group comes to a screeching halt, and you can almost feel Jairus cringe as they stop moving, because Jesus was touched by a woman. Someone comes in the back of the crowd, it says, and touched him on his robe. And immediately he stopped to connect with her. She's been plagued by 12 years of bleeding, a condition that not only physically and financially drained her, but has left her isolated socially and crippled emotionally. Leviticus 15:25, this will share a little bit of the context. I want you to grasp how this woman felt, not only in the physical ailment. I think that we look at the physical ailment, and a lot of us can possibly connect with that. If you've had an illness you've struggled with, that it's kind of this constantly with you. But we all are capable, actually, now after walking through the last couple months, to get a slight grip of her emotional state. Leviticus 15:25 says this: and if a woman have an issue of her blood many days out of the time of her separation, or if it run beyond the time of her separation, all the days of the issue of her uncleanness shall be as days of her separation. She shall be unclean. What does that mean? That means that she is not allowed to interact socially because she's unclean. And so this condition, I want you to get this. This means this woman has been unclean for 12 years. What does that mean in Jewish culture? She's not able to go to the synagogue or temple. Not allowed in. Every relationship is at a distance for fear of making anyone who touches her or is touched by her unclean for a time. All of her family, if she has any, anyone that wants to show compassion, as they get close to her, as they touch her, if they give her a hug, if they try to help her, they are immediately unclean. What happens after a while? Everyone maintains their distance. All right. Now, we've all walked through a bunch of restrictions from COVID. Distancing, right? And I want you to just play back in your mind, and all of us have encountered it and responded to it probably in different ways, but think about this. You've been isolated from people. There's people you're not gathering with. I remember when it first started coming out, we were extremely cautious with Heather's mom for fear of causing some problem that would hurt her medical condition. And I think a lot of us have seen that. It's been played out. I want you to think emotionally how you felt. You're isolated. You're restricted. Life has been changed. That's just for a month or two. Now, for 12 years, you've been 100% isolated. Take it to this extreme, because it would have been to this extreme and beyond. But instead of the whole world doing it, you're the only one. In your town, you are isolated for 12 years. How would your brain work? If you have no interaction with family in the sense of close personal interaction, you can't give someone a hug for their birthday, you can't say hello, you can't say Happy Father's Day, Happy Mother's Day, all of that is stripped away. You can't even go worship at the synagogue. You're not even welcome there. Even our actions to touch Christ would, by definition of law, have made him unclean. I want you to see the miracle. If she touches somebody, because she's unclean, she makes them unclean. So the act of touching Christ would have made him unclean, but the opposite happened. His response to her was immediate, making her physically whole. And so instead of her making him unclean, she makes him clean. What do we see here? Well, we see the amazing power of Christ. We see the law just resolved in him. And that's what it points to. It points to Christ. But I want us to see the more practical side here as well. He was available to her. He responded to her need. Look, beyond that, he stopped to talk with her, restoring her hope and confirming and solidifying her faith. We would have said, great, he's healed her. Just keep walking. You got to get to Jairus' house. We got a problem to solve. Hey, lady, you've been taken care of. Aren't you lucky? You know you've been healed. On we go. But see, physically she had a problem, but emotionally she had crippled time as well. And she needed to talk to Christ. He needed to confirm her faith. He needed to lift her up. Isaiah 42:3 says this, speaking of the Messiah, a bruised reed shall he not break, and the smoking flax shall he not quench. He shall bring forth judgment unto truth. You see, him stopping in the crowd was not him being difficult, as the disciples thought, or being ridiculous. It was him caring, because she actually needed more than physical healing. She actually needed to talk to the Savior, and he knew that. And so he called her out, and she shares the truth. And he shares something with her, and we're going to talk a little later on. He tells her, you're healed forever. You're healed for good, and actually affirms her faith, and we'll talk about it. Yet we often act and live like Jesus has limited availability. Because we think of Christ's love in theory or toward the masses of people. We see Christ loving the church, and we make it into a big group of people. We forget about Christ's love and availability for the individual, because Christ has a very individual interest and a connection to our lives. Why do we make Christ unavailable? Well, it gives us an excuse for disconnecting from him. Well, I don't have a close relationship, but that's because he's not available. Convenient, right? It allows us to push him away. It allows us to blame him for our lack of faith and trust, to make our faults his problem. I put a question down here. In what way have you pushed Christ away and then blamed him for the distance? In what way have you pushed back from a personal relationship, from personal growth, from personal maturity? And this goes from one end of the spectrum to the other, from the lost all the way to a Christian who refuses to grow, saying, I'm just distant. This is as much of a relationship as I want with Christ. And we love to blame Christ for that limited availability, when in reality, he is available. In what way have you pushed Christ away and then blamed him for the distance? Because we serve the only God who is ready to hear and ready to respond. There is no other religion that has the true God ready to listen and ready to respond. Yet the fledgling faith of Jairus is going to be put to the test. He's obviously in a hurry. I want you to put this in your mind. He told Christ that his daughter is at death's door, and that's exactly what he meant. She's about to die. Time is not a commodity that he has. The fact that the mourners are already at his house when he returns lets you know that there was no time at all. Because it took people coming to say that she's passed away, and before he could even get there, there's already mourners there. It reminds me of a horrible call I received about 10 years ago. My cousin Aaron lives in Colorado. We don't talk that often, but periodically we would speak, and I get a call from Aaron in Colorado, and he's asking me to pray right then, immediately, because his brother Jake's daughter, Ashley, who lives in Maryland, they're in Maryland, she has fallen off of a boat, and they can't find her. And so I am standing there at the S&K Men's Warehouse on a Saturday, I think it was, and I get a phone call from a cousin in Colorado who is just asking me to pray right then because his niece fell off a boat. Jake is diving into the water. This is what Aaron tells me. He's looking. He's circling where she fell off. Aaron gets off the phone, and then I'm just waiting. Time is not on anyone's side. The tension of the ticking clock, I still remember that, because you get this call. I think I even called my mom to find out what in the world is going on, because this is just a random call from a cousin. Does she know about it? Yes. It's just the tension of a ticking clock is there. And you know that every moment you don't hear anything, the probability of survival went down. Because you know they're going to call you if they find her. And then you find out the worst is true. They can't find her. She certainly passed away. There is no hope. Because when someone falls off a boat and it's been 20 minutes and they can't find her, and then it's an hour, and then it's two, hope is gone. As Christ is dealing with the woman, people come from Jairus' home and announce that his daughter is dead. And what they're saying is there's no hope. Hope is completely lost. It's over. Leave the master alone. Sure, it was worth the effort, but he didn't make it in time. Jesus hears them say that, and in the midst of that, he turns to Jairus and says, just have faith, believe. Because in the midst of that crushing news, Jairus is going to experience firsthand the awesome capability of Christ. Because he believed in Christ to heal his daughter. And he's going to realize that not only does Christ have victory over disease, but death has no power over Christ. Jesus has the power to heal. I want us to first take the woman. And now Jairus has seen this. He's watched this woman with this issue come up and get healed. We see Christ remove the pain. When the woman finally comes clean about who she is, Jesus tells her, go in peace and be whole of thy plague. Verse 34 at the end. Behold, she is to be completely healed of what has been plaguing her. And by the way, the word plague, it implies a whipping or a scourging. So she is being disciplined in the most severe way. That's what the word plague means in Greek. You're completely healed of what's been punishing you violently for 12 years. Yet his power to heal doesn't end with disease remediation. It encompasses the reversal of death. He restores to life, proving, as Atkins notes, his authority over the power of death. See, when we come to the little girl, we find him coming in and say, damsel, I say unto thee, arise. And straightway the damsel arose and walked. And that "and walked" is critical. She didn't just start breathing again. She got up and she's hungry. I love the fact that Christ closes with a very practical thing. Get her some food. She wants to eat. See, death was reversed, yet the disease that brought the death was also removed. The reason for saying she walked was to show that she was brought back to life and to complete capabilities. She does not have what has caused her death. Yet the purpose of the miracles is not just physical healing. We're going to see that actually next week when Christ does very few miracles in his hometown, because they were unbelieving. You see, the miracles were to reveal the truth about him, to show that he was the Lord and Messiah, and to lead sinners to saving faith. It doesn't mean that everyone he healed had a saving faith, but the point of miracles was to point people to him, to lead a sinner to saving faith. Christ has the power to heal physically, but more importantly, he has the power to save. He raises her from the dead. He doesn't want them to talk about it because he doesn't want to be known as the magician that raises people from the dead. He wants people to know that he came to redeem them for all eternity. That's perfectly pictured in the woman's healing. I read the end of verse 34, which was, "Go in peace and be whole of thy plague." That word "whole" translates a Greek word that talks about health and soundness. Be sound physically, be healthy physically. I try to pronounce the word, but I butcher it, and I'm afraid someone here knows Greek, so I'm like, well, I better lay off that one. But here's the interesting thing. The beginning of verse 34 says, "Daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole." Same verse. Now, why in the world would Mark say, "You've been made whole"? By the way, you've made whole. We have one word for two Greek words. See, the word that's translated in this first portion, "thy faith hath made thee whole," that word is sozo, which is the root word meaning to be saved. In the New Testament, it's used for salvation, not for physical healing. Because later in the verse, the next phrase actually, he says, "Thy faith has made thee whole," as in eternally saved, redeemed. And then he says, "By the way, you're whole physically. You're not going to deal with this illness anymore." And that's where we get the two words meaning whole, complete, sound, but in two separate contexts. The point is, her simple faith was a redemptive faith, not just a desperate launch into the dark to fix her physical problem. This woman is redeemed, not just restored to physical well-being. It was her faith that made her whole, not some magic robe or ritual. Because Christ is telling her, "You are redeemed for all eternity." Why? Understand this, the point of the miracles was to lead sinners to saving faith. Look, physical healing's great. I think every one of us right here knows someone that we would love to have the physical healing of God be put on their life, to have the miracle happen, to say they're whole. I think all of us have people that we'd love for him to say Talitha Kumi to and have them come back from the dead, physically to be with us. I don't doubt that there's somebody on our mind for everyone that's sitting here. But the reality is Christ came to heal us for eternity. And that physical healing, as amazing as it is, still results in ultimate death on earth physically, because Christ's focus always remained on the eternal. Why had Christ come? It wasn't to be their king then and there that they wanted. He wasn't there to just heal all the disease that was in Israel. And think about how many miracles he did. It would have been a kind of an amazing time to be around because, well, if you're sick, you get healed. Encounter Christ, get healed. And that would have massively changed the culture of the day. It'd be hard not to have the influence of that. But he came to give eternal life. He never lost focus on what he was there to do, and that was to redeem mankind, to buy them back. Sin had separated, and he is buying them back. And I put down here, he has the power to heal and the power to save. Yeah, we often act or live like Jesus has limited capability. Sure, we'll make Jesus into a superhuman, but we neglect the fact that he's the God of the universe, the creator and sustainer of every function we see in the world. We forget that Christ holds the world in his hand. Hebrews 1:3, Colossians 1, I think it's 14. Maybe it's 16. Just read the whole book. It'll be good for you. The fact is, he holds this world in his hands. He is the God of the universe, creator, sustainer of everything we see. When we don't see him the way we're supposed to see him, we see him as a superhuman, but not the God of the universe, we tend to work to achieve our own sense of balance and worth. We may be consumed with doing religious deeds. There's a host of people, when you read them, they're consumed with spurning anything religious. Trying to right, trying to prove their worth without God. To pretend they don't need him or to pretend they can earn it, one way or the other. You can read all the famous philosophers that have rejected Christ, and they make some bold and arrogant statements that will never stand up in eternity, and we know it, and the scripture tells us that. What are they trying to do? Achieve their own sense of balance without the Savior. What do we often do in the church? We try to achieve some sense of balance by our religious deeds because we view Christ with limited capability. The fact is this, Jesus is fully capable, and he's actually the only one capable. There is no religious deeds that we can do to enhance our capability or to fill in the gaps that Jesus doesn't take care of, because there are no gaps. It makes me wonder, in what way have you undermined the capability of Christ and elevated your own? See, that's the danger we face as believers oftentimes, even as unbelievers. Christ is not sufficient to save. He's not all that is needed, and so we find a way to elevate ourselves in what we do, how we live, what we talk about, the bravado we put out, those that are lost that write these statements. I've quoted this a couple times with other people, but I think it was Bertrand Russell, was an atheist agnostic guy that wrote, and someone says, when you die, what if you die and you face God? And he says, I'll point to God and say, not enough evidence, God, not enough evidence. And we see that arrogance, right, and say, how dare you speak to God that way? And yet we turn to God and say, not capable enough, not capable enough. You need my work. You need what I do. So I can, in some way, be the God of my own life. See, that's what we turn it into. In what way have we undermined the capability of Christ and elevated our own when we have no capability outside of Christ? He has the power to heal, and most importantly, the power to save. Kind of close out. Think about an amazing 24 hours that's taken place here. Jesus headed out across the lake at sunset, and a storm arises of such magnitude that seasoned fishermen fear for their lives. Jesus calms an uncontrollable storm, proving his power over nature. And I want you to see this. That means Katrina, that means tsunamis, that means anything that nature can throw at us. So when you're sitting in a place that struggles with earthquakes, you can be as arrogant as you want. The second the earth starts trembling, you can do nothing. There's no amount of money to fill the pit. There's no amount of money to keep your building from falling down. Nothing you can do, no matter how athletic you are, no matter how popular you are, no matter whatever it is, nature strikes and we're all put on the same playing field. And he proved his power over nature. They land on the eastern shore and are immediately confronted by a demoniac indwelt by a host of demons called Legion. Thousands of demons who represent the full force of Satan's minions and a power against the work of the Savior. And with one word, Jesus cast them out, proving his power over the supernatural. There was no fight. They approach ignorant, actually, no idea that this is the Savior. And as they get close and they realize it, they only realize it because he says, get out. And the only reason they have to respond to Christ is because they have to obey. They cannot not do what he tells them. And so he shows his power over the supernatural. Now he heads back to Capernaum on the northwestern shore. And when he and the disciples arrive, they're instantly mobbed by the crowds again. It hasn't been long since he left. There he's confronted with two unique and pressing needs, a prominent man about to lose his daughter and an outcast woman who has suffered for 12 years. The woman is healed, and though the man loses his daughter, Christ brings her back to life, proving his power over the physical. Imagine anything natural of nature that could cause a problem he is in control of. Imagine anything supernatural, the forces of evil coming against him, he has the power over it. And then look at your own life and the physical things we struggle with are all encompassed in disease and death. Any physical thing, and he crushes disease and death. And here's the point, and one of the overarching points that Mark is trying to make out of these three scenes. What a mighty God we serve. Because we serve the only God. Everything else is a fabrication in man's mind. You can do a cross-section of all the religions, from Buddhism to Islam, and you find a God created by a human being. They had a dream, they had a vision, they had pithy statements, whatever it is, they found a way to create a God made in their image in one shape or form. We serve the only God, not made in man's image. We can know with certainty, though, that we are not beyond his availability, and nothing we face is beyond his capability. But I want to remind us of the two questions. In what way have you pushed Christ away and then blamed him for the distance? Oh, he's not available. That's great. That religion is good for you, but it's not good for me. And we people do this, right? They pretend that he's unavailable or he's not necessary, whatever it may be. They pushed him away and then blamed him for the distance. And in what way have you undermined the capability of Christ and elevated your own? And that can be as ugly as what Bertrand Russell says and says, I'll tell God he didn't give me enough evidence. To us as believers, pretending we earn some sense of righteousness, and it's not just given to us in Christ from his sacrifice on the cross. Let's pray together. And Father, thank you for this opportunity we have to gather together to study your word, to see your power on display. As we look over these last 3 weeks, we've noticed your power over nature, your power over the supernatural, your power over the physical, and what we have is a complete painting in front of us. We see you as the only God. Yet here in this specific scene, you've manifested to us in the midst of pressing needs, you see us individually. That in the midst of our own sense of balance and worth and attempting to earn our way, you have proven to us that you are uniquely and only capable. I ask that as we tend to push you away and pretend that it's your fault, and as we tend to try to earn our way and pretend like it's necessary, that our hearts will be broken, be submissive to the fact that you are available to us, and that we'll run to you. And that we'll run to you with our complete need, not trying to find any capability in ourselves, not elevating ourselves, but instead being fully reliant upon you. We ask that if anyone here doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, that they have been running from you. Maybe they have the arrogance of that one writer, or maybe they don't speak out that boldly, but they don't know you as Savior. They haven't gone to you. That they'll recognize that you are a God who is available to his creation, and that you are capable of redeeming us for all eternity. In your precious and holy name, amen. Let's all stand. Joe's going to lead us in a song called My Heart is Filled with Thankfulness. And as we sing this together, I hope you'll reflect on this, that Christ is fully available to us, and that Christ is also eternally capable for us. Worshiping with us this morning. I want to mention again, we have the memorial service this Thursday at 10 a.m. We're hoping that you can make it out for that. And if you're able to help with the meal that follows, there's a sign-up sheet on the back, again, for sides. And if you're making a hot side, please go ahead and grab one of the pans so that we can put it in the Sterno warmer thingy to keep it hot. How about that? And this Wednesday, we will not have Bible study this Wednesday, or the next Wednesday, and then we launch our home groups. And again, if you don't mind signing up on the back table, whether it's Culpeper, Orange, Madison, or it's Zoom, that'll be very helpful. Those that are watching live stream, if you can please let us know if you're going to be watching it via Zoom, because that'll change maybe what we do here in Culpeper. So I'd appreciate if you just let me know if you're planning on watching it Zoom or not. Joe, do you mind closing us in a song?
We'll close our service singing the last verse of Come People of the Risen King.
Come young and old from